Hello everyone, today my partner Judica and I will present a demo on real-time image analytics on edge devices. My name is Maggie Du. I'm a machine learning developer on SAS Deep Learning team. I focus on the development of computer vision algorithms. I joined SAS in 2018 after I got my PhD in statistics from NC State University.
Hi, my name is Jyotika Kargaria. I am a Principal Solutions Advisor. I work in the Internet of Things division at SAS, specializing in business applications of machine learning and deep learning. I have a PhD in Astrophysics and Planetary Sciences from University of Colorado at Boulder.
Okay, in a typical computer vision project, a user may have some images or videos in which they want to find something, such as identifying faces in the image. No matter what insights a user wants to find, a computer vision project usually contains three basic steps. First, acquiring images for analysis. Very often, images are in high volume and even in real time. Second, processing images through an analysis pipeline, which typically involves deep learning models nowadays. Third, understanding new images using the analysis model from the previous step by deploying the model to the place where images are generated, such as an edge server connected to a camera. In the next slide, I'm going to use the photo of a dog and a cat of mine to illustrate the differences among some computer vision tasks. The left one, image classification, is mainly giving a label to an image. And this particular image can be labeled as animal, dog, or cat. The second one, key point detection, involves finding multiple interest points in the image and can be used to find the facial landmarks of an object. As shown in the example, we use blue dots to highlight the eyes, the ears, and the nose of the animals. Object detection is to place a bounding box for each object in the image, so we can have the object type and location simultaneously. The last one, image segmentation, is a different approach. It looks at the entire image and assigns each pixel in the image to a predefined category, so we can know the boundaries and shape of each object. When it comes to the new image scoring, there are several reasons why we want to do the scoring on edge devices instead of on the cloud. The strongest driving force is a low latency. The round trip data has to travel between edge and cloud is completely avoided. And at the same time, the risk of being hacked during transmission is reduced. It also helps to lower the budget as we don't need to upgrade our data center constantly for data storage. Now we have some basic ideas about computer vision as well as a need for edge deployment. The next thing a user wants to figure out is how those steps live in a modern IT architecture. This slide presents a typical architecture for computer vision that has a server side for model training and an edge side for online scoring. On the left-hand side, model training usually happens on the server using some raw images or videos that have been previously collected. We load the images to the server, pre-process them if needed, like resizing or cropping, then we use them to train a deep learning model. Once we have the model, we save it using a portable binary format called ASTOR so that it could be deployed to various types of devices. On the right-hand side, for model deployment, it usually contains two flows, one to read the model and the other to stream in the data from either a local file or a camera connected to the device. I'm going to use the street scene images for autonomous driving as a demo to show how it works. I used 4,800 images to train a lightweight deep learning model, which can assign objects in the image to 13 categories. As in the sample images, objects in different categories are masked in specific colors. For example, all pixels of vehicles, including the dashboard of the driving one, are in medium blue, and pixels of roads are in green. After having the portable model, we use different devices to predict new images that are not included in the training set. Here we show a comparison of computing power and scoring FPS of several GPU devices. Jetson TX2 has the lowest computing power, while the scoring speed of it is 10 frames per second, which is totally enough for self-driving of daily use. Here I'm going to play a video generated by Jetson TX2. You like the video. Next, my partner Judica will show you another use case of image analytics on edge.
Thank you, Maggie, for the introduction and the nice example. So in my section, I'm going to talk to you about a use case using computer vision application. So the specific use case will be around surface mount technology, which is basically a method in which electrical components are mounted directly onto the surface of a printed circuit board. And the electrical components that are mounted in this way are referred to as surface mount devices. Examples could be your resistors and capacitors that you see mounted on a printed circuit board. So the particular use case within this technology is known as a head-in-pillow defect that we are interested in talking about today. So this head-in-pillow is essentially an assembly defect in which the bumps from a ball grid array, it doesn't melt together with the solder paste on the printed circuit board. An example of how that looks like is shown on the graphic on the lower right-hand side of this slide, where you can actually see a good solder joint being differentiated from a head-in-pillow defect. You can see that in the good solder joint, both the BGA and the circuit board solder have melted together, but they have not joined very, they have joined very well in the good solder joint. In the case of the head-in-pillow, you'll see that there is a distinct difference between both of these solders, and they have not joined very well. And when you look at the picture, it almost looks like a head resting on a pillow, and that's where the name comes from, is head-in-pillow defect. So this is the type of defect we want to understand using computer vision application. So in order to do defect detection of HIP defects, we work with these machines known as X-ray inspection machines. So these are big vision inspection systems that manufacturers have, and they're available in different wavelengths. For example, we also have optical vision inspection systems, and those vision inspection systems helps you to look at the component themselves. So you can actually look at the capacitor or you can look at the resistor on top of a printed circuit board. In the case of X-ray vision inspection, one can look at the joints, which is not observable in the optical wavelength. So what happens is you have a printed circuit board that you insert into one of these machines. The machine has a camera that takes several images, it scans through the printed circuit board and takes images of the joints themselves. An example of how that data looks like is also shown on the slide. So essentially what you get from the data is this array of those dots on a board, and those are essentially representing all the joints on the printed circuit board. And some of these joints are defective, most of these joints are actually very good joints. In this particular case, the example of the defective joint is highlighted under the red square. So that is basically your defective joint. In order to use computer vision in order to analyze these defects, we need some samples of defects and some samples of non-defects so that we can build an image classification example. So in order to do that, we went through various samples of these data. We extracted and cropped out the defects as well as non-defects, and generated a training set. So the training set has got defects as well as non-defects, and you can see examples of defective joints on the top right-hand side, and you can see examples of non-defects on the bottom row of the sample. And if I were to ask you to look at this data, the training sample, and tell me, you know, from looking at it, if you can see any visible difference right away, it's impossible to tell if there is a difference between the defects and non-defects, because it just looks the same. So initially when we were working with this data, we weren't even sure if we were going to be able to solve this problem at all. but we tried different types of pre-processing techniques, and we actually were able to see certain features emerge when we started working with the data. So to give you an example of how that looks like, one of the techniques that we tried is known as histogram equalization. So essentially, histogram equalization is used to improve contrast in images. And the way it does that is by spreading out the intensity range of the pixels over the entire image. So when we applied that technique to the raw training set, we were able to actually start see some features emerge from that data. So when I actually look at now the defects and the non-defects, I can see certain differences between them. For example, on the top half of the slide, when you look at the defects, you see that they're more circular and more symmetrical, whereas when you look at the non-defects, you can see how they're more spread out. You know, also in terms of the size, also in terms of the outer surface, you can see that there are some inherent differences. The other thing we did was also look at image comparison. So you have a bunch of HIP non-defects, and they represent the non-defective samples. When you do an image comparison using SAS, it returns a self-similarity index. And that's a value that ranges from 0 to 1. And if it is equal to a value of 1, it means that the images you are comparing are totally identical. And as the number goes down, the it basically gives you a metric for how dissimilar the images are. So we took the non-defects and then run the image comparison technique. And you can see the spread in the SAS similarity index. It's very close to 1, and there is a spike at near a number 1. But when you do the same thing with the HIP defects, you can see there is a bigger spread in this SAS similarity index. So all these initial tests were done to see if there are inherent differences just by looking at the pixel information of the images itself. And we actually were able to see that, yes, there are some differences. So once we were able to capture the differences, we pushed it through a model training example. So what I'm showing you here is using SAS DLPy to actually train the model on those images that went through the histogram equalization. So after going through the pre-processing steps, we had a set of images for defects and non-defects. We pushed it into a VGG16 architecture using SAS DLPy, and we were able to build a model. And the results of the model were pretty good as well. So we were able to actually get a misclassification error of 5.7%, which is very good given what some of these manufacturers are doing today, because it's mostly a manual process where operators are essentially looking at these defects, as well as doing certain measurements, physical measurements, where they actually measure the eccentricity, the thickness, and the diameters of these joints. And from that, they determine whether something is defective or not. So just by using computer vision directly on the images will help their time and will enhance their productivity quite a lot. And as you can see, you know, from the validation data set, 48 of the defects were classified as defects. And from the non-defects, there were 82 non-defects that were classified correctly, and then 8 of them that were classified incorrectly. And on the right-hand side, you can also see an example of applying the model on the validation data set, where we can see that HIP defect was classified correctly with 91% probability. And moving forward, the idea and the hope is that at the for the operator, at the software that is installed in the machines, the operator would have the ability to override what the deep learning model would suggest to them after scoring. So what you can see here is an example on the very last hand side of the column would be the answers that the deep learning model would spit out. But the operator on the left hand side can either accept those changes or can override the answers given from the deep learning model. So it gives you enough flexibility to change things if you wanted to. In any case, it really does enhance the productivity of the operators. And the final thing I want to talk about is deployment of models. Maggie talked to you about how we work in the multi-phase domain, where the model training, where we build the deep learning models, happen offline. And once we get the A store out of those models, it gets pushed into a real-time deployment engine. We use SAS Event Stream Processing Engine for the deployment piece. So in this particular example, the same scenario is applied, where the deployment actually happens on an edge device. In this case, the edge device is the machine itself where event stream processing is installed. And the scoring logic, which is the analytic item store, the A store, comes from the deep learning models that have been trained offline in an offline setting. And then the inferencing happens on the machine itself. And once you gather more and more data, those data could be fed into the training set to actually, you know, improve the accuracy of models even more, because you don't start out with a lot of defects to begin with. So this could be a nice feedback loop where, you know, more and more data could also be added to your model training, retraining of your models as well. So this is how the whole picture comes through, is, you know, building your models offline, using SAS deep learning, and then pushing the results of deep learning for edge deployment using our real-time streaming analytics engine for a continuous, you know, inferencing of new data that comes through. So that's all for you today. Thank you very much for listening to our presentation.